Now, please welcome to the stage former Vice President Joe Biden.
Hey, folks. It's good to be back. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you all. Folks, I want to thank your president for, we're old friends, we've been doing this a long, long time, for putting this together and allowing us to come and tell you basically the essence of why we're engaged, why we're running, and to take some questions. Folks, I had planned on initially coming here and starting right off talking with you all about education, global warming, immigration, the whole slew of topics that are of consequence in this election. But quite frankly, in light of the weekend marked by the horror and grief that so many people have had to withstand, I think we have to talk, start off a slightly different way. I have to start off a different way. Ladies and gentlemen, the American people may be running out of tears, but I pray they're not running out of will, a will to do something about where we are. We don't need thoughts and prayers out of Washington. What we need is strength and some resolve that we haven't seen yet. You know, the fact of the matter is, there's an escalating acts are not madness. They are driven by hate. And they are a hatred that we have to confront and rip it out by its roots. You know, the hater in El Paso had a military-style weapon, an AK-47 with 30 rounds in it. In Dayton, Ohio, the killer had a weapon, a military-style weapon, with 100 rounds in it. And, you know, but this is about a lot more than guns. I was able, with Dianne Feinstein and others, to eliminate and outlaw assault weapons and limit the number of clips that could be used in a gun. And we'll do it again. But, folks, it's deeper. It's deeper than the issue of guns. The fact of the matter is that hate is on the rise in America. White nationalism and white supremacy, extreme ideology, is growing, and it's growing all around the world. In Charlottesville, when you saw those people coming out of the woods, little fields, literally carrying torches, their faces contorted, singing and chanting the same anti-Semitic bile that was chanted in Germany in the 30s, accompanied by white supremacists, as well as the Ku Klux Klan. And when confronted by decent, honorable people, and a young, innocent woman was murdered, and the president was asked to comment, what did he say? He said what no president has said. He said there were very fine people on both sides. God forgive him. Ladies and gentlemen, the words the president utters matter. The world listens. They understand, and quite frankly, our children are listening. We don't talk nearly enough about the impact this has and will have for a long, long time. We can't fix the problem if we refuse to name the problem. Folks, it's long past time that we, in fact, call out it for what it is. This is white nationalism. This is white supremacy. This is about hate. This is about what happened in the border community. Ladies and gentlemen, the policy of this administration amount to nothing but an onslaught on decent Americans and citizens and those who are seeking to be citizens. Folks, shutting down the Office of the Department of Homeland Security's national security portion, being able to track and deal with white supremacy and all its hate-filled rhetoric and the consequence of it is something that has already happened in this administration. And, Mr. President, it's long past time you stood up to it. Mr. President, it's long past time you addressed it for what it is. This is hatred pure and simple, and it's being fueled by rhetoric that is so divisive and it's causing people to die. Ladies and gentlemen, America is unique in all the world. America is an idea. We hold these truths self-evident. We hold these truths to be self-evident. All men and women are created equal. We the people, in order to form a more perfect union. We've never lived up to that rhetoric. We've never lived up to the Constitution or the Declaration, but we never actually simply abandoned it, walked away from it, as this president has. And it has to stop. We are in the battle for the soul of this nation, and unless we can restore it, all the rest of the issues will not be addressed. So thank you for having me. That's why I'm running, and I'm happy to answer your questions. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Mr. Vice President, I'm back. You mind taking a question or two?
Not at all.
Okay. Well, Mr. Vice President, thank you. I know this is not your first time addressing our UnidosUS participants. We appreciate your friendship and support in the past. I wanted to ask you a question about health care. There's been a lot of folks candidates running for this position of president in the Democratic primaries. What is your position on expanding access to health care for those who need it? And if you could just say whether you think Dreamers and their parents would be covered under your plan.
Two questions. The first answer is that I think we should build on what is working. By the way, the Affordable Care Act that the president passed helped the Hispanic and the Latino community more than anyone else in terms of the number of people that it covered, number one. Number two, I offer a plan that builds on that. Restore all the cuts the president made by executive order in that plan and add to it a public option. The American public is ready for that, meaning that you can buy into a Medicare-like proposal in the Biden healthcare plan. Secondly, we control drug prices as well, that any new drug, and there's bio drugs now, not chemical drugs, that are so darn expensive. We should set up a system whereby you have at the Department of HHS, a group of outside experts that say what the rational price, the starting price for that drug is, because these are life-saving drugs that are on the way, particularly for cancer and other things using the immune system. And then once that price is set, and other countries do this, once that price is set, cannot increase the price beyond the Did I say something wrong? Okay. Beyond inflation. Lastly, with regard to, I think that anybody who, in fact, is here in the United States, who is able to buy into the plan like anyone else can in America, should be able to buy into it. So yes, the Dreamers, and by the way, if and when I become president, they're in, it's over, they're citizens. This is where we got to move to. I really mean it. I don't know if that answered the question. I'm trying to watch the clock.
No, can I get another question?
Sure you can.
So you've talked a little bit in the past about your ability to work with others, and particularly people on the other side of the aisle. I guess, you know, we issued a poll today that actually said that Latino voters appreciate pragmatism and understand that we may have to find some compromise along the way to get to solutions. Would you tell us why you think you could get to those solutions, knowing that we're a little polarized right now?
Well, look, one thing you can't do is compromise on principle. There are certain principles you do not compromise on, period. No, I really mean it. And I've never done that. But you can compromise in order to get something done that significantly improves the status and concern of the issue you're most concerned about. And folks, the reason I think, look, let me give you an example. Remember how they went after Obamacare right after we got it passed? I thought it was the best thing the president, he did all the heavy lifting, I just helped, and got passed. Well, you know what? The vast majority of American people, including the Latino community and all communities, didn't even understand it was Obamacare. All they knew was that their pre-existing conditions would be covered. 100 million people would be able to do that. All they knew is they could keep their kids on a policy if they had one until they were 26. All they knew is that there were 20 million more people got covered. It wasn't until they started to take it away, Janet, that all of a sudden, you found Republicans saying, no, I'm for that. Because I went into 24 states, mostly purple and red states, campaigning for candidates, 69 of them. We elected 41 Democrats who took on Republicans on health care, straight up. You didn't see any Republicans running around last time saying, I want to do away with pre-existing conditions, I want to do away with. What's happened now as it relates to the issues of health care, but beyond that, in terms of immigration, because that's what I think is one of the center most consequential issues we have to solve quickly. We need an immigration bill, which we go into if you have time. But here's the deal. The reason why I think it's changed is all of a sudden, people are realizing, my God, I didn't realize what was happening. I didn't know what was going on at the border. They've now seen family separations at the border. They've now seen kids be put in jail, in cages. They've now seen families separated. They've now seen the horrific nature of how this president and the border security people have handled immigration. And they're sick of it. They're angry. Complicated by the fact that they now seen again what happens when you do not deal rationally with the Second Amendment. The Second Amendment says, the fact of the matter is you can deal rationally with it. Universal background checks. As I said, Diane and I got past the assault weapons ban, the number of clips in a gun, background checks for the Brady Bill. They've now seen it, and they're ready. And by the way, when they're not ready to agree to it and they can't get Republicans to vote, we go into their districts and we defeat them. No, I'm not joking. Here's the thing. As your nominee, if I'm your nominee, I'm going to go into those red states. Doesn't mean I can win every one of them, but it sure in hell helps the senator running in that state to win. It sure in helps the Congress to win that state. And just go through the southern states and see what happens. And by the way, the polling data shows I can win North Carolina, I can win Florida, I can win Georgia, I can win Texas. But it's a long way out. It's a long way out. So you try to, and last point I'll make, the fact of the matter is, on some issues, there is a consensus. Our politics is broken, not the fact that we don't have the same ideas. Look, at the end of the last administration, he'd already won. I was still able to put together a bipartisan group to spend almost $9 billion at NIH in cancer research. It's a common concern of everybody. There's certain things that are consequence that everybody is for. The politics is broken with Trump, but none of it works unless we get rid of Donald Trump.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's thank Vice President Biden for joining us today and sharing his views. Thank you so much, folks.
Every time I'd leave my grandfather's home, he'd yell, Joey, keep the faith. My grandmother yelled, no, Joey, spread it. Go spread the faith. We're gonna go this